This is Conversations with Mike Sparks.
Are you concerned with the state of America, your state, your community? Then you're in the right place. State Representative Mike Sparks. He and guests are here to talk about local politics, history, faith, and freedom.
All right, folks, listen to the conversation, Mike Sparks. Hopefully we've got a good show tonight. Before I get into my guests, which I'm excited about, Dr. Raj, MTSU Marketing, I want to welcome Jeremy Spencer, our trusted intern. Jeremy, how you doing?
Doing great, Mike. How are you? Doing
good. And Connor, what's your last name?
Haynes.
And tell listeners what you're reading. I come in, I was curious what he was reading. I figured it was some left-wing woke book. But tell everybody what it's about.
Hey, I'm reading Hillbilly Elegy, the book by the now Vice President-elect J.D. Vance.
Yeah, what inspired you to read that?
Well, I watched a movie on Netflix, and I really liked the movie, so I said, I love reading books, so I was going to buy the book after I watched the movie.
Good for you. Did you vote?
Yes, sir, I did.
Can I ask you voted for?
I've never said it on the air just because of my job, and like I'm supposed to be like non-biased, so I feel like in my job.
Yeah, maybe we shouldn't talk about it.
Yeah, but
Bart may be listening. I'm kidding you. But I want to pay a tribute. There was something really sad happened Friday. A lot of folks have seen it. There was a guy that was hit on a bicycle. Jonathan, nickname was Mohawk Hamilton. A lot of folks have seen him around Smyrna, Murfreesboro. He rode a bicycle, had a Mohawk, and it was like a chopper-type bicycle. And I'm sure y'all seen him around town.
Oh, yeah, I know who that is.
Yeah. And, you know, I happened to have lunch over at the town center, Smyrna Event Center, rather. And great place for lunch, by the way. They do catfish on Fridays. And went over, hung out with some folks. And my friend Tony Campbell, I heard him talking about it and said he was struck on near Creekmont on Lashford Highway and struck and killed. And, you know, what's very moving about this, that... You know, I thought I suffered some tough times growing up, walking to work, car breakdown, walking to work, getting rides. You know, I never rode a bicycle to work. I never had to do that. And I don't know how many, I wish somebody could tell me how many miles he rode that bicycle. If somebody knows it, text me. My number is 525-3198.
I don't know the exact miles, but I can attest that he rode it. I'm imagining he rode it all the way from Murfreesboro to Smyrna or wherever he went. Because I'd be going to work in the morning, and I would see him going either that way or that way, either or.
I've seen him about a week or two ago.
Yeah, and leaving work, he'd be going that way or this way. So.
I mean, I'm sure there's thousands of people that have seen him, but he was hit. He was hit over there near Creekmont, and I guess going towards Murfreesboro. The driver, my understanding, hit him from behind, going the same way of traffic. But the accident occurred at 6:17, is what was reported with WGNS. But there is a GoFundMe account out there. I think they've last time I looked, it was up to about $5,800. So folks want to help him a little bit and just you know help. I don't know if he had much family left. If folks know more about him, feel free to text me, 615-525-3198. But just a sad situation. I think Scott Broden's covering it. Dan Epright's covering it. I know WGNS covered it. But, you know, when we're on the road, we need to really watch and get off our phones. Mm-hmm. I'm guilty. I'll admit I'm guilty of it. And pay attention. And, you know, Nashville Highway is a dangerous road right in there. Mm-hmm. And so anyways prayers for Jonathan Hamilton Mohawk. I think Donald Brock was telling me they're going to do an event over there at we called it Snake Pit growing up. I can't think of the name of the little bar right there by the Latava Italian restaurant, Front Street Pub. I think they're going to do something, a little tribute, do something for him. But anyways, you know, it's just sad, man. You know, you think of, you know, Dr. Raj, I was sitting there pondering. I was like, man, God has blessed me so much.
Yeah.
You know, and then, you know, I got a nice car or cars and, you know, got a beautiful wife for 35 years, and this dude is riding a bicycle to work and gets hit and killed. But thank you to Sylvan Restaurant for giving him a job. The Omni Hut, he worked at the Omni Hut. You know, I worked at the Omni Hut when I was young. Walked to work a few times. Didn't ride a bicycle because he couldn't ride a bicycle. The train tracks. We rode, walked up train tracks. But Councilman or Vice Mayor Steve Noe in Laverne gave a nice little tribute on Facebook to him. So thank you, Vice Mayor Noe, for but thousands of people, man. If it wasn't thousands, hundreds of people paid a little tribute to him. So, you know, we never know when it's our last day. We just need to thank God for everything done for us. But let me segue over here to Dr. Raj. Dr. Raj, welcome.
Thank you very much.
You've been up here a couple times with me, haven't you?
Yeah, one time. Yeah.
You know, I had your class a few years ago, and what was, you know, I have a lot of irony in life, odd things that happened to me. You know, we voted to block TikTok. And next thing you know, I'm in this guy's TikTok class, and I'm like, oh, my gosh, I hope these students don't know I'm a lawmaker. And a couple of them did.
You
know
what I mean? And they'd ask you
they'd ask me. They asked me tough questions, man. Remember that one guy? What was that guy's name? Sharp.
Izzy.
Izzy, yeah. Sharp young guy.
Yeah.
He says, because I kept telling you, you could talk about Facebook. Oh, you talk about TikTok.
TikTok, yeah.
He said, why would you tell Dr. Raj to talk about TikTok when you voted to block it? I said, well, there's a thing called the First Amendment. It's first for a reason. Ain't number two, number three, number four, number five. It's first for a reason. Mm-hmm. And we should be able to have these discussions. So welcome to the studio.
Thank you.
And how's things going for you?
Pretty good. Busy. It's that time of the semester. So last few weeks are busier. So.
Well, I wrote a story about you. I hope it's okay. If you
can no problem.
It's on my Tennessee Ledger, .com, TennesseeLedger.com. It was hacked by the Chinese back 6 months ago. Finally got it rebuilt back. And anyways, got it done a little article about you. And I seen a video how you grade papers. Man, that was rough. Tell us about that video. It's a TikTok video you made.
Yeah. So my USP is... what I do, well, funny things that students can relate to.
Yes.
That's all. So I concentrate on that area. And one of the thing is where everybody jokes around that professors don't read and they just give random. So that's what I did. I said, okay,
yeah.
I'll put A B C D on a stair and just throw the assignments, and wherever it lands, that person gets the thing. He did really well.
Who gave you that idea? That was brilliant.
I mean, just I don't remember who gave, but just one of those.
Man, that's brilliant.
Yeah, it was fine. It is. I mean, it is close to almost 4 million views.
So is that really how you grade papers? You just put the A's, B's, and throw the papers
I wish it was that easy. You know, I wish I could do that. I could grade the whole thing in 10 minutes, you know.
Yeah.
No, unfortunately, no.
Well, I appreciate your class, appreciate the engagement back and forth. And, I know you care deeply about the students. And you care about their well-being.
Absolutely.
It's kind of like I was kidding you about what you told the students. You said, it was the first day of class. It was one of the class. What's the other class you teach?
Marketing management. Yeah.
I went, and I guess you could say.
Yeah, you were
audited, I guess, for a couple of days. And you told the students. And I love your honesty, because a lot of these students, man, they're stuck in their iPads or cell phones.
Yeah,
and you said, if you're going to go into marketing, you need to be engaging. You need to be a people person.
Exactly. And marketing is that kind of business where you have to be an outgoing person. You need to be talking to people, because sales is all about talking to people, developing relationship, you know, being on social media and that kind of thing. Just that kind of
And where did you tell them to go to if they
okay, now you're going to put me in trouble, because this is
I loved it.
My office is on the fourth floor in my building, and my accounting is on the same floor, you know. So I walk up every day. I don't want to be. So I just jokingly told that if you are that kind of person who is introvert and doesn't like to talk to anybody, you can be an accounting major and sit in a corner and joke. But there's nothing against accounting. It's just I wanted to tell the difference between marketing and other area of work like accounting, where you have to. Be out, you know.
Yeah.
You can choose to be where you sit in your room and just do your work, but marketing is not one of those.
Yes, I got to keep. But it was what was funny is you were so serious about it, which to me makes it funnier.
I actually meant it. This is actually what it is. You know.
Has anybody ever like changed? I mean, like really thought about that and just dropped a class or something?
Oh, all the time. We get a lot of people who are some other major, and then they take on other account marketing classes, and they say, you know what? I like thinking like that. I like these kind of activity, and they've changed their major. They do that. Students change their major all the time.
Yes. Well, you've got some brilliant students in there. I'm expecting a call at 5:18 from Scott Golden. He's a GOP chairman. Okay. And the reason I wanted Scott to call in was Diwali. Am I pronouncing it right?
It's very, very good pronunciation. Diwali.
The is it the Indian celebration of lights? Am I saying it right?
Yes, it is. Where what you do is you light up either just bulbs or just it's called diya, where in a semicircle kind of thing you put some oil and then you have a cotton wick and then just you burn that. Yeah. So is it the
Hindu celebration of light or lights?
Yes, Hindu celebration. In mythology, a Hindu celebration was when Ram, who went to kill one of the bad king, and he comes home, and to welcome him, they put up lights everywhere.
Okay.
And that's what this is. So this is
based on a true story.
Yes. Supposedly. Okay. Yeah. Yes. Yes.
Well, I've always kind of been fascinated by the Indian culture. I mean, you know, the work ethic. You know, the entrepreneurship skills. I mean, folks come over here and they take full advantage of the American experience, starting businesses, going to school. Mm-hmm. In fact, I reached out. Is it Cal Patel? Mm-hmm. All right. I guess he owns a few hotels, mm-hmm. right? Okay. And I was asking him what brought him over. Mm-hmm. And I think it was one of his neighbors had a friend that was studying here in America, and he came over and he said he was so excited to get his driver's license, and I got a kick out of what he said. He said, I learned to drive really quick over here. He says, driving to India is bad. He says, if you can drive there, you can drive anywhere.
Absolutely, and that's because, first of all, we drive on the left side of the road. That's one thing. And the second, just the densities.
Yeah.
I mean, like, it's a country with four times more population than America and one third the size. So you can imagine it's 12 times the density. So it is crowded and there's so many cars on roads. So it's hard to drive. You know, I don't drive anymore. I used to drive all the time, but now when I go back home, I prefer not to drive.
You've got a Lexus RX 350. What is it? Cause I heard you talk about Lexus in the class.
I just bought a Tesla, so I became.
Oh, you did?
I became that stereotype Indians who have Teslas.
I saw it down there.
Yeah, you like your Tesla.
I really like my Tesla. I really like the ease of driving and all that, and the technology of everything connected through a screen is. I like that, you know.
But how do you explain Elon Musk and Tesla? I mean, it defies all probability.
Actually, I'll tell you very honestly, people think that Tesla is just fantastic thing that he has done. I think more impressive is the SpaceX.
Oh, yeah.
The SpaceX is way more impressive than Tesla. And you watch, this guy is going to become a first trillionaire as soon as SpaceX goes public.
You know what? I mean, Tesla doesn't even advertise, correct?
They don't advertise.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Absolutely, they don't, you know, because people who drive for them are the advertisers, you know. They tell their friends. I'll tell you very honestly, it used to be very expensive as recent as 6 months ago, you know.
Yeah.
And they looked at it and said, you know what, if we bring the price down to more realistic level, more people will buy. And that's what they did. And that's why,
What color did you buy?
Gray.
Great.
So I have a Model Y, and right now it is the number one selling mid-level SUV in the country. You know?
Oh, really?
Really good, and I really like it, yeah.
Connor, let's take a quick break, and we'll be right back.
Hi there, my name is Rusty Russ. I, along with my sons, Luke and Reed Russ, sell real estate for Stevens Group in the Middle Tennessee area. We are a team of professionals who have the knowledge of local and regional market, which allows us to offer you a full range of commercial, industrial, residential, and investment real estate services, matching our resources with your needs. You can call us at 615-366-8900 or at my cell, 615-406-5553, or email jrusty@comcast.net.
AFFI is Middle Tennessee's premier choice for pest, wildlife, and moisture control. They specialize in those difficult and unique cases. You can reach them by phone at 615-300-2395. That's 615-300-2395. Or stop in at 200 Glen Rose Lane in Smyrna.
Hey, Middle Tennessee, it's Mark from the Safe House. And now the security riddle of the day. What's less secure than a fake safe from a big box or furniture store? Joe Biden's fake border policy, of course. But hey, there is good news. This time next year, Joe Biden will not be president. So drop by the Safe House and check out the largest selection of safes in the Southeast. Build a wall around your valuables with a safe from the Safe House. We have certified delivery crews to deliver and install your safe. Don't let a crackhead or illegal deliver your safe. With over 30 years in the safe business, the Safe House is the place to buy a safe in Tennessee. So go to NashvilleSafeHouse.com.
When I say VFW, you probably have some visions of a smoke-filled bar with a bunch of old-timers eyeballing you. Well, the Stones River VFW is doing things different. No smoke-filled rooms, no turning prospective members away, and a strong emphasis on camaraderie and community. We believe in instilling our American values in our young people through numerous programs such as Voice of Democracy, Patriot's Pen, Scout of the Year, and VFW Teacher of the Year. Stones River Post intends on becoming a driving force to help, aid, and assist wartime veterans. So if you're one of those veterans with a campaign medal and you want that sense of purpose that you've been missing, then give our recruiter, Andrew Farr, a call at 615-490-5715.
Hey, I'm Floyd, and I'm inviting you to join me at CR. That's Celebrate Recovery. We meet at Family Worship Center, 3045 Memorial Boulevard, on Sunday at 6 p.m. We're a 12-step Christ-centered program that offers help for all the hurts, habits, and hang-ups that's causing you pain. The program works if you work it, and I'm proof. For other CR groups, go to CelebrateRecovery.com and click on the group finder. Hope to see you soon.
My wife and I enjoy going by Yard Sale, Inc. We usually go to both locations, the one in Smyrna as well as the one in Murfreesboro. A lot of times on Saturday mornings we stop by, and their inventory changes weekly, so you never know what you're going to see, and it's mostly open box. The name fits it. It's exactly that. It's a yard sale. If you don't totally agree with the price, the staff is always friendly and nice and willing to work with you.
That's the Yard Sale store in Smyrna at 111 Enon Springs Road West in Murfreesboro at 204 South Front Street, and online at bestdealintown.com.
All right, we're back. Conversation Mike Sparks. I'm your host, Mike Sparks. Got my guest, Scott, you there?
I'm here, if you
hey,
can hear me.
Thank you, man, for such a short notice, brother. I appreciate you calling in, Scott Golden, Republican Party. Scott, I was so impressed with your comment to the day at State Capitol on the celebration of Diwali, the Indian celebration of lights, which is goodness over evil. Welcome.
Thank you, thank you. That was a great event, and the guys at VAPS do a tremendous job every year. That was last year. I was out at the temple for the festival, and so this year was a little. You know, as you know, it was October 31st was the day of Diwali, and yeah. Of course we were. You and I were right in the thick of
yes.
Election season.
So yes,
we were spread out across the state.
So I bet you were excited for all the elections, weren't you?
We were pretty thrilled with where we ended up in Tennessee. It's you know, we ended up just losing. We actually had a better shot of adding to our numbers in the state legislature. You know, normally when you think of a supermajority Republican state, we're all on defense, but we were still trying to go after people and make the case. You know, but when you have a supermajority, you're going into, you know, very tough districts, D+5, D+6, and so yep. You have to kind of make a case why the Republicans have done such a good job here in Tennessee, and hope that that message translates. So
yes,
we ran some great campaigns, had some great candidates, came up just a little bit short, but won everything that we were supposed to do, and by wide margins, so we couldn't have been more thrilled with how Election Day came out.
Yes, boy, that George Soros spent a lot of money, didn't he?
Mm-hmm. It's all of these groups. I mean, you know, people don't realize it, but the Republicans, we're getting outspent. You know, nationally, I think the figures are going to end up being somewhere around $1.6
billion. Wow.
For Kamala Harris's campaign, and maybe right at $1 billion for President Trump's campaign. So, I mean, you know, you're talking significant money when you're getting outspent by $600 million.
Yeah, they outspent me. Now, they outspent me 6-1.
That's several representatives of our incumbent were outspent, and it's all money coming in from out of state.
Yes,
you know, New York doesn't have competitive races, California doesn't have competitive races, so they are using Act Blue to filter money across the state.
Yep.
Not to mention the Soros groups and everything else that's out there in the Democrat liberal ethosphere. So. It's something that we constantly have to work on and remind people, even in a super majority Republican state, that our members are not safe. And you know this better than anybody, is that, you know, Republicans have only had government in the state of Tennessee for a little over a decade. The previous century and a half was all controlled by the Democrats.
Yes.
So this is a relatively new experiment, and one of the things that we were saying on our statewide bus tour was, you know, 25 years ago, the Democrats never thought that they would lose control, and here they are. And it's a reminder for us that, you know, every day we've got to be out there working,
yes,
showing people why our policies are doing so.
Yes, exactly. You know, I thought about you on the way in here, because I was trying to find a picture of you and Trump, and it reminded me, I seen a couple pictures of Trump and Marcia, I guess when we were all at Municipal Auditorium. You remember that?
I do.
Because you were sitting in front of me, and Marsha Blackburn let me take her seat, and she was on stage with Trump, and Trump looked over at you. You remember, he said, "Thank you, Scott Golden," and pointed at you, and I was like right behind you. I thought, that's pretty cool. You know what I mean? You know?
President's fantastic. I cannot wait for this next 4 years. I'm really impressed with many, many of his cabinet picks, and I know he's putting together a government. Boy, that's got to be a tough job of people that want to serve and trying to figure out how best you can put people there to implement the policies that you're looking for. So, talk about hitting the ground running.
Yes.
Certainly learning from the mistakes of whatever mistakes that there may have been in 16 and 17. The fact that he is, you know, basically down in Mar-a-Lago, here's my administration, let's get started. Of course, he had a great, I was seeing some of the clips from the USC fight this weekend, and Mike Johnson was with him, and a lot of the cabinet members were with him. So, you know, when Madison Square Garden starts erupting, and the guy that won the fight this weekend gave him the belt, President Trump's riding a pretty good wave. And I think it just, I mean, honestly, Representative, it speaks to how frustrated people are.
Oh, yes, definitely.
With big government, and they just, you know, I mean, I hate to say it, but coming out of the pandemic, I mean, nobody really trusts anything. And you really just want to get somebody up there that's going to drill down to you and just tell it like it is, right? And that's honestly what President Trump
he does.
Tell it like it is.
You know, I was going to ask you, this is a serious question now. I hate to put you on the spot, but I've seen the interaction between Joe Biden and President Trump. What was that, a few days ago? Welcome in the White House, and Joe Biden had the biggest grin on his face. I mean, that's the biggest smile I've seen on his face like in a long time. Do you think Joe Biden may have voted for Donald Trump?
I cannot. I'll just say this: I cannot wait for the history to be written about those periods of really between the CNN debate, what happened with President Biden. President Biden saying, "I'm running again." I mean, for 3 weeks out there saying, I'm running again. And then one Sunday night, he says, okay, I'm not running again. And then 12 hours after that, he says, I'm endorsing my vice president. So,
yes.
I mean, when the annals of those stories are going to be written, and they'll come out eventually. But I think my interpretation is that smile across his face says that I still think I could have beat you, but for whatever reason, I wasn't on the ticket, and you ended up winning. So
yeah.
Whatever's going on there. And, you know, look, I think from the positive perspective is maybe that relationship repaired a little bit. You
yeah.
know, they were supposed to meet for 15, 20 minutes and ended up meeting for 2 hours. And so maybe that's a great, you know, kind of coming across the aisle. And it really does seem, I mean, I was a part of it when President Trump was elected in 2016.
Yeah.
And the vitriol, you remember they were marching in the streets in New York 24 hours after the election.
Yeah.
He's not my president. And the Washington Post saying, let's impeach him, and all of these things. And I do feel that maybe it was the size of the victory, or maybe they didn't have enough bought into Kamala, but it just seems like everybody's just kind of like, all right, let's give President Trump the benefit of the doubt.
I think
let's do some good things for our country.
We just got to work together, you know, and I'll say this, I may tick off some people saying this, but the problem Republican Party has is we, in my opinion, we eat our own, we kick each other when they're down, and we got to work together. And I was glad to see President Biden be as gracious as he was to President Trump. And I was kind of cringing what President Trump was going to say. I don't know if you feel that way. I'm like, oh, I hope he just keeps this polite and be gracious on his own terms as well. But I'm excited. I know you're one of the hardest working guys out there, and you're always accessible. And I do appreciate, I know others appreciate what you do, and your comments within the Indian community at the state capitol was very gracious. You know, you acknowledged Senator Heidi Campbell.
Yeah.
Because you had that blue scarf on.
For those of you that weren't there, they were handing out shawls as you came into the event, and they ended up giving me a blue shawl, and I remarked that I don't get to wear a whole lot of blue in my daily occupation. I've got a closet full of red, but I don't get to wear blue that often.
And
I told Senator Campbell that it's a nice color. Unfortunately, I just don't get to wear it much. But it, you know, then those guys are just fantastic members of our community.
Yes.
I mean, you know, the temple that they have and the impact in their profession, all the way, really. I know Bob lives down in Murray and Kai's up in Kentucky, really along I-65. And it just goes to show, I mean, really, it's actually a credit for what you guys do in the Tennessee General Assembly, that you've made Tennessee such an attractive place to come, because these guys are coming from New York and California and Illinois and states that are just, you know, that are very unstable.
Yes.
And they're coming here looking for business opportunities and bringing great ethics, and it's really just a testament to how well the Tennessee legislature has done. And I, you know, that everybody knows, I mean, you're sitting in traffic, you know, from Clarksville to Murfreesboro, but the reality is that these people are coming because of everything that we've created here in the state. And it's just fantastic that we're kind of mentioned in there with Texas and Florida, and Tennessee
right
there is the states that are doing it right.
So yes.
Credit to you guys. Looking forward to January and getting the legislature started back up again.
Well, we appreciate it, Scott. You gave great comments, as well as John DeBerry and Secretary of State Trey Hargett and Heidi Campbell as well. So thank you, Scott. Scott, call on me if I can.
I was fortunate to speak before John DeBerry, because he's the best. He's the top of the list when it comes to
He is. Just such a great guy. Well, thank you so much, Scott. Appreciate what you do, brother.
Thank you. Thank you for all you're doing. Congratulations. Go have a great Thanksgiving and a great Christmas. Get some rest for the session.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much.
All right.
Take care. Yeah, Dr. Raj, it was impressive to hear all the leaders speak about the Indian community, and just a very, very loving people.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And
the Indian community in this greater Nashville area, Murfreesboro included, and all that is actually growing pretty good.
Yeah.
There are a lot of new restaurants coming up. There are a lot of new stores coming up. So the support is coming up, and they're pretty hardworking and reasonably successful. A lot of doctors, you know.
Yeah. What's your favorite restaurant here in Middle Tennessee?
In Middle Tennessee, in Nashville, it's in Franklin, you know. Franklin has a really good one. Murfreesboro has one good
Indian restaurant, you mean?
Yeah. Nashville, Franklin has one very good Indian restaurant called Namaste, you know.
Okay.
That's pretty good. Murfreesboro one, both are
all three of them are actually not bad category, yeah. You know. So none of them are bad. The clay pit has been there for some time, and it's decent. The one my favorite is, of course, the one that's on, what's the name? I forget the name, but on...
By the hospital down?
Yeah.
The church? Pioneer Baptist?
Memorial. Not on Memorial. I mean Medical Center Parkway.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Not familiar with that.
Yeah.
What's the one up there off Harding in Nolensville? Something.
Well, it's off Harding and Nolensville. Yeah, that is called Taj Mahal.
This one I'm saying is called Egg something.
Oh, Egg-holic, yeah. Right? So what right next to that building there is a huge Indian store called Patel Brothers.
Oh, okay.
So if you're facing the Egg-holic, if you look on your right, there's a huge store. That's the biggest Indian store in this area.
Okay.
That building in which Egg-holic is, that's owned by the owner of Patel Brothers. And so there are five or six smaller stores that are all either Indian or international related. So okay. There is Egg-holic, there is one Middle Eastern, one. Then there is a full-fledged Indian restaurant, which is actually a good one, called Taj Mahal. And then there is an Indian store.
Within the store next to it?
No, this is in this building where you saw Egg-holic is.
Okay.
So right in that line, right next to each other, you know. Okay. All of them are international food related. So
yes.
Decent ones, you know.
Now, when you look at other businesses, do you automatically start thinking, what are they doing to market? Do you kind of look at that? Okay, are they using TikTok? Are they using YouTube?
Absolutely. And I think that comes with our my work, you know. That's what I look at, you know. Especially if they don't advertise, or they don't market, and yeah. Like, why are you not doing it? You know, I even go up and sometimes tell them, like, you should do something like this. My wife said, stop being a professor all the time. You know?
Really? Well, it's like that old adage, when you have a hammer in your hand, everything looks like a nail.
Exactly.
You know, you were sharing with me, because I stopped by your office, I don't know, maybe a month ago? Popped by there maybe 6 weeks ago. You were in, was it D.C. or New York?
Mm-hmm.
What city were you in and somebody spotted you?
In Washington, D.C. What do you mean? That's right. This is Roanoke, Virginia.
Okay.
Yeah,
Roanoke.
Okay.
Roanoke. And I was driving down and we just stopped by for charging my Tesla, actually, you know. And we walked in to just use the restroom and buy something to drink or eat, you know. And the person who was working there said, hey, I know you, you know. And we started talking about it. And he had just graduated from Virginia Tech and he was looking for a job. And we just made a TikTok that time. He said, hey, if anybody's looking for a job. And that TikTok got almost 10,000 views. I mean, where else can you get 10,000 people to see your resume, you know? So
yeah, wow.
That is very cool.
That is cool. I've seen a video. It's maybe some of you guys would know who it is. It's that comedian out of like Los Angeles. He always wears a little hat. Like
there's a lot of them.
Like what's that guy? He and he's making fun of Kamala Harris's accents where she goes, and then he makes fun of her little Indian accent. Man, it's hilarious. Yeah. Have you seen it?
No, I've not seen that one, but I've seen many comedians making fun of Indian accents.
How do you look at that? Do you?
I mean,
do you embrace it? Is it funny? No, or do you get offended?
I always embrace it. I always find it funny. It depends upon what they're trying to implement, right? Or what they're trying. What is an implied thing in that? Yeah. If the implied thing is fun, then I'm okay with that, you know. Sometimes it gets to a racist tone, which is kind of like, okay, all right. I don't like that part.
Yeah, yeah. The what do you think we as a culture have gotten away from, like, laughter and finding humor? Or do you think it's like clean? Sometimes I think we've got to learn to laugh at ourselves sometimes.
Sure. You know? I honestly think we have become too legalese now. I have to be very careful of what I speak in class. I have to be very careful of my syllabus has become like 6 pages long, and three of those is just really seriously, I'm telling you, three of them are what MTSU wants me to write, and they send us the exact text that you need to have, you know. And I'm pretty sure they have some good reason to do that, but I just think it's just too much, you know. Yeah. Students are very careful of how they speak to me because they're afraid of hurting my feeling, or which is okay in some sense, but then we're extra careful. So if they're making fun for the in a fun manner, then I'm okay.
Rob Snyder. I looked up. It's Rob Snyder.
He's a well-known guy. I mean, he's an actor. Yeah.
To me, it's hilarious. I'm a little different, you know. With students today, have you seen them change over the years? I mean, how many years you've been teaching for 20?
20 years, yeah.
Have you seen them, the personalities or the interactions just change?
Yeah. Actually, you're absolutely right. What I have seen, some students are not as talkative as they used to be.
Yes.
And that I have seen. I've seen people more busy in their phone while in class than they used to be, you know, because there were not that many cell phones. But that may be the reason. But now, that constant urge to update and see what somebody has posted is so huge that they can't wait an hour to go back and look at it. So they have to see that time. Yeah.
Go ahead, Jerry.
I just did.
Do you get on to students?
I don't get on to them that much because if you get on to them, then they're not. I mean, like, if you feel that is more important at that time, then go ahead and do that, you know. I try to make my lectures engaging so they are looking at, you know, paying attention to me rather than just looking at the phone. You know, I mean, that's. Yeah. If you are going to compete with their attention to the phone, you're going to lose every time.
Well, speak of that, because you talked about that in class.
Yeah. So what has been happening, and it's not the TikTok that made your attention span to 18 seconds or 20 seconds or 9 seconds or whatever. It is the 9 seconds attention span that has made TikTok, right? As students are more instant information thing, they're like, I don't have time. Tell me in few minutes, few seconds. Those 5 minute long attention span is gone. If you don't engage me in first 30 seconds, then I'm tuning you out.
Because one thing that I wanted you to do was to take on the issue of mental health. You know, and my idea, because we've got that mental health conference. I hope you can attend December 9th. At Motlow College. And one reason I want to do it at Motlow, because a lot of folks, believe it or not, don't even know we have a community college in Smyrna. And I've got one of the young men right here in studio that did know about Motlow. And so I want to host it over there. We've got Department of Mental Health and Substance Abuse, I think Collegiate Recovery, Hope and Hustle Recovery will come by, and Tennessee Mental Health Cooperative. But the idea I had for you, Dr. Raj, was to talk about how these students decompress. You know, how do you wind down from a rough day, and do it in the shorts. Do it in the 8 to 10 seconds. Maybe you do, but you also have your other. It's not just you would blend it in, and then you'd have the MTSU pennant in the background.
That's right.
And I mean, let's just face it. You have more of a social media influence than probably everyone at MTSU.
Combined,
yeah.
I mean, I have 20 times followers than MTSU. their account,
obviously,
I have way more influence than them, and whatever, however the number of that are accounts MTSU department.
Do you ever see the social media team? Are you in a way affiliated with the MTSU social media team?
Not affiliated. So I'm a little careful because if I'm affiliated, then I have to. Okay. I don't want to be known as the guy who's representing MTSU, which I'm not. Right. You know.
So you know, there's no iron team, don't you? There's no iron team.
That's right. So, but if they come to me to do something, I always say yes.
Always.
Yeah. I would love that. Yeah. I have told them that anytime MTSU wants to use my videos in advertising to students, and they have done that in the past. And
well, with your problem. with us blocking TikTok, and what's the latest on that? With I think the Trump administration, he's saying he's not going to ban it. Is that what the latest is?
That's right. Now, let me tell you very honestly. One of the person who owns 18% of TikTok is a huge Trump supporter.
Okay.
I cannot imagine Trump going back and looking at him and saying, I'm going to ban TikTok.
Yeah.
That's just one personal thing. Second, why would you want to ban something which majority of the young people like?
Yeah.
Make it more safe if you're worried about Chinese hacking. If you're worried about data, then put the data in America. I think what will end up happening is the data that is there will be on American soil. Mm. So it can be monitored rather than, it's never in China. First of all, TikTok is not, the data is not stored in China. People think that's wrong. It's stored in Singapore, but it's not America. That's why everybody's concerned about. So what they're talking about, I think what will be that they will host, I think Utah or somewhere, they have this huge farm, they call data farm, they call it, and it will be hosted there, and that will work.
Well, do you trust Facebook with information?
I personally don't. Now, this is a very personal thing to me. Yeah. I don't like Facebook. I don't like what they did with 3, 4, 10 years ago, you know, when they sold the data. They actually sold the data. So what what we are worried about, that Chinese will hack and get our data, you can buy it on Facebook. You can buy it on Instagram.
Yep.
So,
right? What's that? It was a film by Netflix. It was Social engineering. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean,
it's a really good film, but it's like, this is what they're doing? Like,
this is what they did openly. So I don't know why people are, if you're worried about data, then worry about Instagram, Facebook, everything. Because they're actually selling the data.
Yeah. That surprised me in class when, because you didn't do Facebook and you done TikTok. And I was like, man, this is really such a strange parallel here that you don't do Facebook, because I don't want to do TikTok because I don't want to look like a hypocrite because we voted to block TikTok.
Sure.
You know? So, and I've asked folks, what do you think about that? And they're like, nah, I wouldn't do TikTok. Terica Black, that's been helping me, Tiffany, that was that I thought was going to come by tonight, and they both were like, nah, I wouldn't do TikTok, Mike.
Because everybody saying, well, your data will be hacked, you know? I mean, honestly, if some Chinese guy wants to look at my data, they can have it. You know, I mean, like, what are they going to get from me? You know, I mean, like, what? So I don't. My even name is not on that. So, like, how do they even find anything? So, but that's a different thing. I mean, this beyond my understanding of that data. Maybe there is something that they can look into it. You know, but so do every other social media.
Yeah.
Why? So it's a lot more political, and I don't think it's going to get banned.
Yeah.
I mean, they've been trying for the last 8 years.
Well, I don't think it's going to get banned anyway, because Trump has seen what, when he branches out to different media platforms, he went on podcasts. You know who listens to podcasts? His voters, normal everyday people. And when he sees, like, you know, normal everyday people are using TikTok, he's like, I can use this to my advantage.
Exactly. And if you notice, he went to all the young ones, you know, the streamers, the Twitchers, you know, the Rogan shows, you know, I mean, that's what got him the young votes.
Right.
Exactly. Why would he want to ban the most popular thing for young people?
Yes. Yep. Well, let's talk about AI, the bots, and some of this propaganda that can get spread by AI. Bots and deep fakes. How concerned are you with deep fakes?
Well, I mean, so I am way more educated and knowledgeable than an average person. That's why I should not say that, well, shouldn't bother with it, be careful, but it's not that easy being careful when you don't. So I think the solution is to educate people. So, for example, if I get an email from I got an email that said that there is a package for you, and it's one of those bots that has done that. Now, how do you look whether it is fake or not? You go and look at from where it came from, to heat, and it says Raj and R-A-J-E, R-A-J-O, R-A-J. Well, that means it's just descending out randomly to people. Yeah. So if you are careful, you can actually see that it's pretty fake. Second, there are software that will actually stop those bots. And then you start with the mindset that if there is if there is something, there is a good chance it might be fake. And then when that's where how you start with, you know, rather than believing everything that is in front of you. You know,
a few years ago, we had a lot of the protests at the state capitol, and I invited Dr. Larry Burris. And I really think a lot of Dr. Burris. And we're talking about First Amendment free expression, the right to protest, the right to peaceably assemble, peaceably.
Yeah.
Okay. And not tear down statues, not burn down Nashville City Hall that probably cost $10 million. Mm-hmm. Peaceably assemble. Mm-hmm. I see a lot of, I hate to say fake news, but I see a lot of false narratives. Mm-hmm. So I literally had Dr. Burris on the radio with me. Scott mm-hmm. Walker, he's still got the clip. He played it back about a year ago. Mm-hmm. And my argument was the media is not covering these things honestly in a fair manner. Mm-hmm. Dr. Burris's position is they are. Okay. So I'm literally, this I talk about synchronicities. You've heard me talk about it. Mm-hmm, the late mm-hmm. Dr. Carl Jung talked about these things. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I call them Godwick moments. I was on the floor of the outside porch, which I guess you'd say the south side porch, looking over Legislative Plaza. All the protesters, about, I don't know, about 20, 30 protesters, a lot of troopers. It was really the heightened time. And I was doing the radio show live with Scott and Dr. Burris. Well, I'm looking over and I see the protests and I'm saying, hey, protest out here, whatnot. And I seen a guy in a wheelchair, Dr. Raj. And I look back over and I seen the same guy laying on the floor at the Legislative Plaza. And he was in convulsions. His body was shaking. And so I looked and I thought, what's going on? So I yelled out to the troopers to go render aid. This is live on the radio. Scott can play it back to verify this. And the troopers look at me because they couldn't see down there because mm-hmm. the protesters, but I could see on the perch I'm on. Mm-hmm. So I'm yelling to the troopers, hey, the guy's having a seizure. You need to go down and render aid. So they carry some medical equipment. And the protesters are blocking the state troopers. They're blocking them. So two reporters came out there. One was with a Tennessean. I forgot the girl's name. She moved to D.C. And then a guy with NPR was there. And I looked at the reports. I said, are y'all going to cover this? You're going to cover this in a fair manner. You know what they did? True story now. I've been saying the First Amendment's under attack. Okay. Because if you're reporting things in a false narrative, there's a threat to our republic if you're spreading propaganda. The story was from PBS. Not PBS, NPR. The story was, Mike Sparks tries to tell me how to do my job. That was the guy's story. It wasn't about the protesters. It wasn't about the guy that could have died. It wasn't about them blocking aid. The Tennessean story, I was told she put it on Twitter in an honest manner. I think took a picture, put it on Twitter. And somebody told me that she got, like, would you say it? She got hit with so many bots and all this, mm-hmm. like, attacking her. That she literally took down the Twitter post because it was just, you know, and I literally watched that happen in real life. Mm-hmm. And I told Dr. Burris, I said, here's what's going to happen. They're not going to report this. They're not going to report this. Yep. And they didn't report it. And Scott played it back. We've got that live mm-hmm. to prove mm-hmm. what's going on. That's one reason I do like Donald Trump, because he does. You may not like his tweets. You may not like, and sometimes I don't like some of the things he says. Sometimes I'm like, could you hone it in a little bit, you know, and not talk about Cheney being shot, and you know, I just you gotta rein us in sometimes. But it really is a threat, and 90% of the media is controlled by five huge corporations, and that's why Joe Rogan and these people are just kicking their tails.
Yeah, yeah, and that's why young people are believing social media influencers more than they are believing. Legacy media, because they're not watching it, and when they don't believe it, so they look at the people who are like them, young people who are saying things which they relate to more than what any.
Well, Trump did speak about college debt. I thought I seen a clip the other day recently, which is something we've got to do. We've got a caller. Caller, go ahead.
Hey, Mike. Thanks for making the radio airwaves great again.
Thank you, brother. I like that. I like that. Did you hear? I just thought about you. Did you hear Scott going on the radio with us?
Yeah, yeah. That's why I was giving you a call.
Did you hear Donald Trump on with us about 2 weeks ago?
Well, it it's amazing how you've got that much pull to get the president-elect on the radio. Mike Sparks,
you know, it's funny that there's suckers out there that believe me. They believe there were suckers out there that believed that.
Well, he sounded legitimate, and no doubt in my mind it was really Donald Trump. He took time out of campaigning in Pennsylvania to
it was good. Yeah, it was good. How you been doing?
I'm good. We're getting ready for a big wedding this week. My son's getting married.
Oh, congratulations, man. Yeah. Congratulations.
We're in wedding mode, getting down the stretch. I just wanted to call and say keep up a good fight.
Thank you. I want you to meet Dr. Raj sometime. Maybe he can come speak to the GOP one day. Yeah, okay.
Get him over there speaking to the Republican women, you know.
We'll do it.
That's the real power brokers in this county.
Amen. Well,
you ever make them mad?
Exactly. You know. Well, thank you so much, Austin, for what you do, brother. Thank you for those books too that you gave me about my dad. Okay.
Yeah. I thought you'd enjoy those. So.
God bless you.
All right,
man.
Mike.
Thank you. Now we'll see.
Bye.
Yeah. Austin's our GOP chairman. I was telling about my dad flew on the B-17s in World War II, and he went in and grabbed two books about the 8th Air Force and gave them to me.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I thought that was really, really sweet. How many hours you teach in next semester?
So in College of Business, most of us teach what we call 4 classes or 12 hours, 12 hours, as they call it. Yeah. And I teach 2 face-to-face, 2 online, typically.
Yeah. Well, you know, with the young people today that are interactive, how do we change that? How do you get these students to be more engaged? I mean, look, Jeremy's on his phone right now, and Ricardo's staring at the screen up here. I mean, they're not even paying attention. What do we do to change it?
Well, the thing is that then you have to do things that interest them, right?
Yeah.
You have to do things like, so I tell all the time, when I'm in class, I have to be entertaining also. If I'm that boring professor who's just monotone talking, they don't want to pay attention to that. They have to like you. They have to relate to you before they learn from you, you know. So that has been my thing, and that's why I always like to keep it engaging. Mm-hmm. I like to talk about what I educate myself in their thing, you know, and then I have an advantage over social media. They always look up to me and like, oh, wow, he's...
Well, I think it's cool. You're relatable to him, you know.
Yeah, exactly, well, that's what I do.
The one video I made, if folks want to know more, go to TennesseeLedger.com. It's my top story with you on there. The one about you hear a student walking down the hall yelling at his mom about what he's eating for supper.
Yeah.
Where did you get that idea?
I always talk about that, you know, sometimes I hear these people talking to their parents like, I cannot imagine talking like that today when I'm like twice their age, you know, with my dad, you know.
That was based on a true story, the one that you did.
Exactly, you know. So
the student is yelling on the phone.
On the phone, like, they're talking as if to their parents, as if they're like their friend or something. Like, you don't talk like that. You don't cuss with your parents like that.
Yeah, so, like yelling at his mom, like, I want chicken nuggets.
Yeah,
I said
exactly.
I need chicken nuggets.
And they're like, you should be... So those things are just amusing to me when I listen to people talking to their parents in that tone and,
you know,
that kind of way.
I had to get on to Ricardo, and I'm putting him on the spot here. Ricardo went out and got ripped off on a haircut. He spent $36 on a haircut. And I told him, I said, dude, they seen you coming. You're a sucker, man. Don't be getting ripped off by people. Didn't I tell you that? Did I hurt your feelings? Because my wife, we own a hair salon. Don't talk about it where you went to and make them mad. No, I got $36, man. I said, we own a hair salon. My wife's going to cut your hair tomorrow for free. But these young people today, I had a dad that drilled discipline in me. You know, my parents were frugal. They didn't spend money on nothing. And today, what worries me with that absentee father, that lack of mentorships, where are they going to find some of the direct? I mean, really, you're a mentor to these students.
I try to be. In fact, I go out of my way and tell them, if you want to come and talk to me about anything, it doesn't have to be class related. Outside of class, come and talk to me, you know. And let me be that person, that adult that you can come and freely talk to. And many of them do.
Well, you probably would have more influence on them than their own parents.
That is a little scary, but sometimes that is true, you know. So I try to be as friendly as I can. I tell them, I have two kids, so when they come to me, I act like they're my kids, you know.
Yeah. No, I appreciate what you do. You know, your class, to me, it's one of the best classes I've ever taken. Because it's hands-on.
Yeah,
I didn't want to take, geology and natural science and biology, because I'm like, what am I going to do with this?
Yeah.
But what you're teaching, it's, you use it, like I used it today when you walked in. I might show a little video.
Exactly. And that's what I tell everybody should need to learn, especially young people, social media, understanding it, content making and all that, because they will be using more and more and more. The legacy media is gone.
Yeah, yeah.
The advertisements are done with, you know. So.
Yes.
I will say the one organization that has adapted social media to its mission perfectly to a T, the National Park Service.
I have they?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If any of your listeners like follow the NPS on social media, Facebook, Instagram, and everything, you get a kick out of their posts.
Really?
You get a kick out of the posts, and it makes you want to go visit like your nearest national park, Tennessee State Parks. We've tried to adapt social media to, I say as if I'm still employed by the state,
yeah.
but no, we've adapted social media to our mission, our outreach.
So. And that is such a good thing, because young people are going to pay attention through that, right? So if doing it, very good.
Real quick, before we're out of town, we've got a few more minutes. I thought my friend Marty Lupp was going to call in. Marty has got two ladies from India. One just got, I think both of them had visited, Sepna and Rocky, is their name. I don't know their last name. I'm guessing it's Patel.
Okay.
I mean, what's the odds? Anyways,
if you don't take a chance, it's likely to be true.
Let's roll the dice. Let's just say Patel. But anyways, they're a sweetheart of ladies, and they're caring. They've done so much good to help Marty. Marty, in turn, has helped them. I think he's getting... One of them started in business. He's a State Farm agent.
Really?
You know, he run me out of his insurance company. I was 17 years old. No. Would not insure me. So he'd get the HELL out of my office. I had a hot rod Camaro, 68 Camaro. And I was waiting on a quote for car insurance. He's waiting insuring him. Mm-hmm. And he come back by my car business. Years ago, the first.com mm-hmm. car company, Tennessee. And he come by, and I was like, I always vowed I'm going to get this guy back. And he come by my office, and I had my chance, and I blew it. I was like, man, part of me, my mom was a strong Christian. My dad just could cuss you and make poetry out of it. And I thought, what path am I going to follow? And I thought, what would Jesus do? Mm-hmm. And so I forgave him and moved on. But forgiveness is a powerful tool. And I think I think at Diwali, they talked about that.
Exactly. I mean, those basic things are true in every religion. It doesn't matter which religion it is. And in Hinduism, it is a lot.
So love is a powerful tool.
Absolutely. Amen. Should be.
Amen. Thank you, Dr. Raj. Thank you, Jeremy. Thank you, Ricardo, for stopping by. And thank you, Connor. Connor, finish that book, and we'll talk about it next week, okay? Folks, we'll talk to you next Sunday.